Today we're talking about Persephone. This is going to be a basic guide to get you started on Persephone when she comes out, so you know how to utilize her from the start. At a later point I will make a more advanced extended guide that goes into all the details of the mechanics with different items, etc. But that's for then, now we just focus on learning to play Persephone on a decent level. In order to do that, we look at the abilities, the leveling order, the overall play styles, the roles, as well as the items. Let's begin with the abilities. We'll actually start with the 1 and 2 and then talk about the passive because it kind of ties in together. So her 1 is Bone Rush. This is a line ability with 2 parts, which allows her to send forward a skeleton, and the skeleton initially charges on a relatively small line and then falls apart, and then it becomes a wider line, and I think the ability moves quicker as well, dealing damage to anything it hits in its path. It will break immediately when it hits a guard, so it can kind of affect the range a little bit if a guard is very close to you. The damage goes from 100 to 300 and scales with 80% of your magical power on a 12-second cooldown. This is your most reliable ability to have an instant clear capability and to also poke enemies quickly. That doesn't mean that it necessarily is your main clear or your main poke, but we get to that with the 2. Other things that are worth noting about this abilities are the fact that the skeleton will kind of start from an offset position. Or rather, if you keep moving while using this ability, then the ability will not fire from where you are moving to or where you have moved to, but rather from where you started firing the ability. So it feels a little bit delayed when you initially use it, because the skeleton will kind of do its own thing the moment you push the button. This is something that you have to practice a little bit in order to aim this ability properly. When clearing with this ability, I would recommend being a bit further away from the wave, because that makes it easier to hit the entire wave with the wider part of the AoE and not miss any minions, though you can hit the wave with the skeleton itself as well. And last but not least, the 1 spawns a seed at the maximum range of the ability. This is actually relatively important because the seed is something that will be utilized in the passive, and the same way that the seeds from the 2 will be utilized, which we'll get to in a second. So this allows you to safely place seeds in positions that you otherwise wouldn't reach without putting yourself in more danger. The second ability is Harvest. Harvest allows you to place a skull on the ground, and this is up to a maximum of 10 skulls placed at a time. However, in addition to that, you can have up to 6 skulls stored basically in your inventory that you can place at any point. This is a bit confusing because you also store the seeds when you break a skull. So when you start the game, you will have 6 skulls in your inventory but no seeds, and later on when you break some skulls, you will have some additional seeds in your inventory, and maybe not 6 skulls at the time if you have some placed already, because the ability has an 8-second cooldown, so you regain a skull for your 6 stacks every 8 seconds. The skull has various purposes. It has 3 stages once placed on the ground. The initial one is a skull that simply heals. After 4 seconds, you get a detonation effect, and after 24 seconds, you get an attacking plant. The plant lasts up to 120 seconds or 2 minutes. The skull, when hit with a basic attack, will heal for 22 to 50 plus 10% scaling. The explosion, which sets in after 4 seconds after the skull is turned into a plant, deals 60 to 220 damage plus 75% of your magical power as scaling. It also slows the enemy by 30%, and it has a decent AoE radius. Due to basic attacks having a slightly increased radius for the effect of the activation of this plant, but not for the basic attack damage itself, it is possible to activate multiple plants at once with your basic attacks. However, activating more than 1 plant will reduce the damage by 50% for the follow-up damage of the second plant, and the third damage again is reduced by 50% of the second damage, and so on until it caps after the fourth plant with a total of 87.5% reduced damage. The third stage is an attacking plant that will chase after enemies and attack them with a cone attack that can be avoided, but you have to be very, very quick to avoid that. The bite deals between 70 to 250 base damage and has 85% scaling. These plants cannot be attacked in any of the stages and do count as an ability and not as a pet, meaning they also apply item effects. Now that we talked about the 1 and 2, you know that these drop these plants on the ground, and whenever you attack a plant or break a plant, you get seeds back. So these seats will be collected in your passive, and you can collect up to 100 seats. If you reach more than 25 seats, you will get to live for 8 seconds after you die. Persephone rises from the ground and can keep on fighting while not being targetable by enemies, and she will deal 50% reduced damage during that time. Her CC and everything else lasts as long as normally though, so this can be very impactful in a teamfight, especially if she gets focused early on. If she has more than 25 seats, she sells the rest of the seats for 3 gold each when going into the base. Her third ability, Flourish, is a 45 range leap forward or backward depending on which direction you are moving in. Its cooldown scales down from 15 to 11 seconds with each rank, and it has an additional effect, or two rather. Plants within 20 units of the starting point of this ability, so from where you're jumping, will immediately grow to their next stage and be activated. That means a skull will turn into a sprout and immediately detonate, and a sprout will turn into a plant that immediately chases enemies. Then the plants that are already leveled up will just be activated and start chasing enemies and biting them. If you have some plants set up around you already when an enemy aggresses on you, this allows for some excellent baiting techniques. Additionally, the next harvest that you use after using your 3 will immediately be ranked up to the second stage. So it's immediately a sprout and can immediately be detonated with a basic attack as well for some extra damage that way. Persephone's ultimate is Grasp of Death, and that is one that I recommend looking at in game to fully understand it. She throws out a cage basically that has an infinite range across the map until it hits a wall or an enemy, and that will lock them in this cage. They are then entrapped, meaning they cannot move out, they're crippled, rooted, and have reduced attack speed. However, they can attack this entrapment, and after 5 basic attacks, it will break. In addition to that, in a radius of 55 around this entrapment, no matter if it is on the wall or on an enemy, other enemies will be tethered to the entrapment. That means they have vines that will not allow them to walk further away from the entrapment than they are at the point that the vines attach to them. They can walk closer to the entrapment and they can walk in a circle radius around it, but they cannot leave the area. The entrapment itself, if it hits an enemy, deals between 195 and 495 base damage and 75% magical power scaling, while the vines deal 65 to 165 damage and 30% of your magical power scaling. The attack speed reduction scales from 20 to 30% depending on the rank, and the duration of the CC is 5 seconds. Cooldown is 90 seconds here. Before we get into the leveling order, a quick reminder that if you enjoyed the video so far, feel free to click the like button, it really helps me out. So when it comes to leveling Persephone, there are 2 options, focusing on the 1 or focusing on the 2. The 1 will give you a bit more reliable poke and more safety because it can be activated from a further distance in general, while the 2 allows for a higher damage output if you place your plan strategically. It also comes with the additional effect that you will have more self-healing in early game, but it will also cost you a lot more mana to place on your plants, which is something you will feel more early game when you're placing a lot of plants and your mana pool isn't that big yet. Since both abilities got nerfed, leveling the 1 is a bit better than before, but I'd still generally recommend leveling the 2. Leveling the 2 early is especially effective if you can invest in early cooldown reduction, so you always have sufficient plants for every wave. On level 1, however, you should always put a point into harvest, as this allows you to place various plants across the map before the game starts, and this will allow you to set up for a massive amount of early poke, early clear, depending on what you want to go for, or even help with jungle camps that way. So in the most standard leveling order, I would put a point into the 1, then a point into the 2, a point into the 3, the next point goes into the 1 again, and then into the ultimate. After that, the priority would be leveling the 2, then leveling the ultimate whenever possible, leveling the 1, and leveling the 3. There's a lot of flexibility here because you can, for example, choose to not level the ult and focus on the CC of the ult, and it will still have a lot of impact, but I feel like this instant super high burst base damage is very nice at the same time, and also the additional attack speed reduction is a good benefit. You can also sometimes consider leveling Flourish earlier, the escape. It really amps up your game in some ways if you can play aggressively, and this is also something that could especially be considered if you're going for a more bruiser style build. And again, you could also consider leveling Bone Rush before Harvest, the one before the two. Now for some playstyle advice. As I said already, stack the flowers on level 1. Where you stack them exactly is up to you. You can, for example, place a lot of them in mid lane and just aggress on the enemy right away. You have a super high kill potential that way on level 1 if they are already grown into the third stage. Or you can place some plants at the jungle camp, at the speed camp. And if they grow early enough, then you can send them out from relatively far away to go for the camp and then run to the lane and probably be there before your opponent. But you can also start in lane with her, so that's fine. You can also place some plants at the mid camp and the red buff so that you have very easy access to those after the first wave. There's really a ton of flexibility in how you can utilize them, and all options are valid to some degree at least. Try to not always build the third stage, the flowers, because they're not necessarily better for clearing. They will turn on enemy guards over the minions, so they're better for that type of aggression. And they also clear with a cone effect and not in an AoE explosion, so they're not necessarily the ideal clearing tool in all situations. If you, however, want to send a plant army after the enemy and you don't care about the damage loss from the multiple hits, then the best idea to place them is to leave a gap in the area where you place them so that you can detonate them all at once or activate them all at once. I would say in most situations you don't want to put more than 3 flowers together in order to not lose too much damage through that. When it comes to using the 3 in combat, I would often recommend going for the backwards leap, especially over walls if you want to get into safety, but also in order to be able to afterwards use your 2 and throw a basic attack forward and immediately detonate stuff again. You can use the 3 to chase aggressively as well, but then often you don't get the full benefit. Often you will not get the plant effect on the right plants that you want to send after the enemy, or they're too far away or something. Also be very wary that if you're playing on a little bit of ping especially, you have to hold down the button for the direction. Otherwise sometimes the game doesn't recognize the input properly and then you accidentally jump into the enemy tower, and that's not fun. When it comes to the ult, the best way to use it is from an angle. Sure, you can go and throw it straight at the enemy in lane, but if your enemy is not too far away from a wall, you can also try to throw it at them from, for example, inside entrance of the mid lane, and that way, even if you miss the enemy, the ult itself will attach to the wall and will still vine the enemy, so they can't actually get away and still take a little bit of damage. Way more beneficial for you overall than completely wasting your ult, because it is somewhat easy to juke due to the relatively big, slow projectile, which is very visible. A quick word on her roles. I think Persephone is a mid laner first and possibly a solo laner second. Unfortunately, I couldn't test better builds that I thought would actually work better for her on PTS because it was down the whole week, but otherwise I would have tried some other builds that I'm assuming would have worked better than what I initially tried. Technically, her jungle clear isn't horrible either. The problem is that it's very counterintuitive to jungle with her because of her kit relying around her having some time to set up things in an area for the two, and that just never happens with the jungle. You're just constantly using your whole kit and using those plants to clear, and you don't really stay in an area long enough to really make use of the effects to the same degree that you can in a lane. You can think of it as maybe similar to King Arthur, who also works in the jungle decently, but doesn't really make the full use of his kit, and especially his passive that way. And now for the items. Starter should be Mage's Blessing. The cooldown reduction is so crucial for her. Even in solo, I would say Mage's Blessing probably feels better on her. When it comes to boots, it's completely your choice. You can go for pen boots or cooldown boots. Both have their reasons to be built and both are useful for her. When it comes to damage items, the first item that stands out is Banecroft's Talon, because during her passive, when she is dead, it's on maximum stacks the entire time, offsetting her damage loss a little bit. However, you gotta ask yourself if you want to build 4 times where you are dead, or if you wanna rather try and stay alive. Another item that I would say is an option is Book of Thoth. This is obviously the more straightforward power item, but it takes the time to stack it. It is nice to have the extra mana though, because then you really never go out of mana with her. Though Mage's Blessing alone is sufficient in my opinion. Divine Ruin is an excellent choice against anyone with healing and is overall a great item anyways. Rod of Tahuti is also a very nice choice for later in the game, especially because it adds so much damage against weaker targets, and she really works well with that. She has enough damage to take someone below 50%, and after that is where she sometimes lags a little bit. Soul Reaver, as far as I was able to test, also gets activated by her plants, meaning that is also a very nice effect for her and overall a good item, even though it's not favored at the moment. Then there are cooldown reduction items. These are typically damage items as well, but I wanted to separate them a little bit so it's not too much clutter in one section. There is Spear of Desolation here, very similar to Divine Ruin really, especially when the enemy team doesn't have much healing. Then there's Shaman's Ring, which with a new patch will have 110 power, 10% cooldown reduction, and the marks last 10 seconds. I'm not 100% sure if it's going to be the best item for her because you still have a lot of front-loaded damage on her, but she does often deal a lot of instances of damage and it can kind of offset these further instances being a little bit reduced otherwise as well. So I think this item might still be good. It might become overall meta for mages. So I want to throw it in here and point it out. I'm not sure if it's perfect yet. Chronos Pendant is also definitely a solid item if you're looking to just go with maximum CDR. And Staff of Murden should be pointed out here. It can be nice with both the 1 for a lot of extra damage or for the 3 to double activate the plants and not get the same damage reduction that other mages would get because the effect is applied to the ability itself and not other abilities that benefit from the ability. So the damage from the 2 should not be reduced. There are also 2 bruiser options that I would probably try for solo if I was going to run her there again, and that I think are becoming more popular, especially in the pro league at the moment anyways, for various reasons, especially to prevent diving, and that's Pythagorean's Peace and Ethereal Staff. Both of these items should definitely be considered on her, and I think Pythagorean's Peace might actually become a lot more popular over time for builds with her, because between the health and the CDR, it allows her to use her 3 more aggressively as well, which is a super helpful thing for her. Another item that definitely falls into this area is Dynasty Platehelm, though that recently got a little bit of a nerf. Gem of Isolation is an item that you can consider, but I had some issues figuring out if it works properly with the plants. It didn't seem to work in jungle practice, but I have to test it a little bit more. So no absolute judgment here. So far, I didn't really feel like I needed it because she has another slow anyways. When it comes to defense items, your options against physical damage really are Celestial Legion Helm and Breastplate of Valor. And if it's more about mixed damage or CC, then Magi's Cloak is great. Mantle of Discord is also very strong, especially in combination with Bancroft's Talon if you're building that as well. And against pure magicals, you can also consider Genji's Guard, of course, because the CDR will always help a lot anyways. For penetration or percentage penetration, I would only really recommend Obsidian Shard. Spear of the Magus can kind of work, but I feel like she doesn't really do enough instances of damage most of the time to fully benefit from this. Maybe if the enemy team is building very squishy overall. Last but not least, there are also some items that need some further testing. Bamba's Mask is interesting, but it got another nerf now, and I'm not quite sure how useful it's going to be for mages in its current state. Polynomicon technically works pretty well with her because she can use it with her 2. She can get the effect from her 2. But on the other hand, she also loses the effect from Polynomicon if she hits a basic attack on a plant without hitting an enemy at the same time. Now, if you're really good with her, you can actually hit a basic attack on an enemy that is close enough to a plant to also detonate the plant, but I would say usually that's too situational. Soul Gem is technically an option as well, but I feel like it's a little bit inferior to Pythagorean's Peace at the moment, and I would probably still get Polynomicon over it if it came down to that, but I'll test it a little bit more. Ward of Asclepius, technically also an item that she can build and she can utilize through her too, but then again, Ethereal Staff seems like a bit of a better option at the moment. Doom Orb, maybe an interesting item because it has a fair bit of power still and it has movement speed, which not many items have anymore in the mage area, which could make for some unique builds, but I'm a bit torn on this one because I don't really know where I would even place it in the build. And Typhon's Fang could be debated as a late game item, especially if you're opting into Pythagorean's Peace and Bancroft's Talon or another similar build path. Despite being intended as a basic guide, this ended up being a lot longer than expected. Persephone is just a really complex character, so forgive me for that. Again, a more in-depth guide will follow in the future, so if you're new to the channel, feel free to click the sub button if you want to be there when that comes out. And other than that, I hope this was interesting and insightful. Thank you guys very much for watching. Hope to see you all for the next one tomorrow. Dewsloth, out.